Please come in. I want. Is there any problem?
Yes, sir.
Excuse me.
I have to do with Professor Gangekar.
You are discussing something with Professor Gangekar. Okay. Because I want to mention the point that you raised. Okay. During the break. Okay. So if it's very important, so go back. You know, and I will not. Okay, it's up to you. Okay, what Gaurav asked me in the during the break is that actually, in some cases we do not know if we actually are dealing with solutions or with suspensions. This is a different way to put your question. That's right. Okay. In some cases, it is really not clear, and I'll mention again the example that I gave Gaurav. For instance, if we take polymers, okay, which have usually a large molecular weight, okay, they can still be dissolved in water, in other solvents, okay, but they show very clear indications that they behave like colloidal suspensions, okay. For instance, you can get a light scattering from these suspensions, from these suspension solutions, okay, even though it looks clear to you, okay? I'm not talking about the visible light, okay? Because if it was in the visible light, you would see the turbidity of the solution, okay? But we can use some other wavelengths, like in UV, like in IR, depending on the size of the particles, of the particles molecules, okay? Which are not wavelengths which are not in our visibility, and you could detect scattering, okay, which is a strict indication that actually you have a suspension, because you are dealing here again with large molecules that the decision between a particle or a molecule is not that clear, okay. So there is what we say, there is a range that we may call a gray range. Okay, we don't know exactly to decide whether this is a solution or a suspension. Okay, so I suggest not what I suggested to Grove, not to stick to the discrimination between based on sizes of particles. Okay. We have to consider the chemical physical properties of these systems. Based on this, to decide actually what is the system that we are dealing with, okay? Not based on the size. Is that clear? So it's a very important point, and what I'm saying in general, that we have to look around. We don't have to stick to a certain way of thinking when we deal with science, okay? This is very important. We have to look here and there, straight ahead, maybe to the back, okay? In order to get a broad vision on the system that we are dealing with. Okay, very important. Okay, so thank you for bringing this, okay? Now, are there any questions? So far we dealt with the electrostatic interactions between two colloidal particles, okay? And we discussed the influence of the ionic strengths on the interaction between the two electrical double layer, or in other words, the interaction between the electrostatic interactions between these two particles. Are there any questions? No questions? Yeah. we are talking just about strong electrolytes, okay? But similarly, although a bit differently, okay, we can say about weak electrolytes too, okay? Okay? Another very important point associated with this, okay, this issue is that the charges on colloidal particles is strongly dependent on the pH. We mentioned it before, okay? Because these are usually the groups, the charge groups that are there on the surface of the colloidal particles are coming either from hydroxyl groups or carboxyl groups and other groups, which their dissociation extent is strongly dependent on the pH, right? So we have to keep this in mind, okay? And this, of course, will influence strongly the strengths of interactions or electrostatic interactions between the two particles, right? It is not here, because here we are just dealing with the influence of ionic strengths, not the influence of the pH, but we have to keep this in mind too, okay? Right, so let's continue. We are getting now into what we call London van der Waals forces. Can somebody tell me what, when we say London van der Waals forces, what are we referring to? What is the origin of these forces? Which one of them? The London or the van der Waals?
London.
Right. And about, what about the van der Waals? Does anybody remember what our, yeah? Between? Yes, that's understood, but what is the origin of the van der Waals? What Gove said about the London, that's correct, I'll deal with it in a couple of minutes, but what about the van der Waals forces? What is the origin of the van der Waals forces? What? No, 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 no. Dipole, right. So, we are dealing here with a multi-atom system, okay, which contains a lot of electrons, right? And also, remember the story about the dielectric constant, okay? Also contain dipole moments, okay? Of different types, depending on the internal structure. So, let's, usually we refer to London van der Waals forces because both of them are attractive, but each one of them has a different nature, okay? The London forces are there because we have interactions between two oscillating electron clouds, okay? Let me show you okay, you will excuse me. I have a very nice video which shows it. But probably I mixed up with the two pen drives that I'm having, so I have to switch to the other one. It's very important, and I want to show it to you. Look at this. I'll show it again. These are two oscillating ionic clouds between two particles, okay? And look how they are coming together and stick together because of the attractive forces of London, London forces. Let me show it to you again, okay? You see? And what are oscillating here and here actually are the ionic clouds, okay? So at one time, they are becoming positive and negative, at one time negative and negative, or positive and positive, but on statistically, okay, they may stick together just because of these oscillations, okay? Again. So this is a visualization of not of of van der Waals, but also London, but more correctly London, okay? In a couple of, in a second, I'll talk about van der Waals interactions. Right, so you have two particles sticking together because of these oscillations. Now, similarly, may happen because of the existence of dipole moments, because of the existence of dipole moments in the system, okay? And again, statistically, these dipole moments may cause two particles, when they come close enough together, to stick in the same manner as London, as the London forces, due to the oscillating electron clouds, okay? So these two forces actually are originating from the internal structure of the particles, of each one of the two particles, okay? And these are attractive forces. Now, remember that I told you that in order to sense these two forces, the particles have to come much closer to each other as compared to the interaction between the two double layers. Remember? Okay, now, usually, in order to sense the London van der Waals forces, okay, the dependence of the energy of interaction is according to the distance to minus one. And for London forces, it is according to the distance to minus two. As compared to the electrostatic interactions, which is according, which behaves according to an exponent of the distance. Okay, I'll show to you in a couple of minutes the whole system, and you will see how we compare between each one of these forces with respect to the distance of interaction. Okay, but due to this, behavior of the interaction of London and van der Waals, okay, they are considered much shorter interaction types, shorter range interaction types as compared to the electrostatic interactions, okay? Which means, again, in order to sense these two particles, the particles has to come much closer to each other as compared to the electrostatic forces, right? So, taking this into consideration, before going in, yeah, before showing this, it is very important to understand that both London, but particularly van der Waals interactions, are dependent on the geometry of the system, okay? And again, I will not go into too much details, but you see here in this table, there are several different, several cases which show the interaction energy, the dependence of the interaction energy between two entities, two particles, so a particle and the wall, or two point particles as a function of distance. And you can see here that, for instance, for these two particles, okay, where the distance between them is becoming much shorter than the radius of each one of them, the behavior is according to h to the minus 1, the distance to the minus 1. Whereas here, when we consider two point molecules, okay, it's according to the distance power to the minus 6, which is actually for London van der for London interactions, okay. And in the same way, we can discuss many other cases that are shown here. You see that in one of the cases, we have, for instance, if we have two cylinders interacting with each other, okay, the energy of interaction is according to h to the distance to the minus 1.5, okay? An important parameter which is associated with the van der Waals interaction is called the Hamaker constant, okay? And the Hamaker constant is a constant which is a constant which is actually in the equation here. We have the Hamaker constant, and in this equation we have the energy per unit area of each one of these spheres as a function both of the radius of the spheres and the distance between them. And the Hamaker constant actually is the constant that combines between these two parts of the equation, okay? So this is actually a constant that has a dimensions of energy, right? A very important constant in conjunction with the London with the especially with the van der Waals interactions. Now, since the electrostatic interactions that we dealt so far with are repulsive, and they are considered here as positive interactions, and the London van der Waals interactions are attractive, okay, they should be considered negative on the other side of this graph, okay? So now we have two sets of graphs. One of them is showing the electrostatic interactions, and the other one is showing the van der Waals, London van der Waals attractive interactions, okay? Since London van der Waals attractive interactions are not dependent on the concentration, we have just one curve here, okay? So London van der Waals interactions are considered very, very strong interactions once. Why do you smile? Yeah, okay. Right. are considered very, very strong once two surfaces are coming close enough together that they can sense this, these forces. A very nice example that we have, first of all, you can see this calculation here, okay, which shows you that the force between two surfaces can get as high as 21,000 newtons, but more nicely is to express it in terms of kT, okay? More than 1,000 kT may be the interaction strength between two particles based on van der Waals interaction, London van der Waals interactions, which is very, very large once, again, once these two surfaces are getting very close to each other. A very nice example we can show here. Okay, all of you know the story of Spider-Man probably from your childhood. Okay, and the question is how Spider-Man used to climb on walls. Okay, but let's go to a more realistic case. Do you know the story of the gecko? The gecko, yeah. You know what's a gecko? It's a lizard, yeah. How does the gecko climb on walls, on surface glasses, you know? Yeah, okay, but how? Does it have any adhesive? Does it use a vacuum in order to climb on the walls? Does it use vacuum? What do you think? What? So, the story is totally different. You know, it was discovered not way ago. You know, it was, I guess, in 2000. I have a paper here. Yeah, 2000, you see? Okay, this was the first paper to be published about the gecko and other other animals that have the same character. Okay, gecko is used in order to climb on walls. Okay, it uses van der Waals forces. Unbelievable, but this is the real story. Okay, and why? Because if you look very carefully on the gecko's toes, okay, it has a very, very tiny hairs. Okay, these are different magnifications of what happens on the toes of the gecko's legs. Okay, very tiny hairs. Each one of these hairs is separately touching the surface while it climbs. And the gecko can control each one of them separately. Okay? And by doing this, the intimacy, if I may say so, of the contact between the gecko's toes and the surface on the top of which it climbs, okay, is getting stronger and stronger, which means that London van der Waals forces between the wall and the gecko's legs is becoming more and more pronounced. Okay? This is how these London van der Waals forces are strong. Okay? This is the strength of London van der Waals forces. But in order to sense it again, the gecko has to bring as close as possible his toes to the other surface. Right? This is the story about the gecko. Now, I want to show you a short movie. Look at this. This is a robot, actually, which was built in Stanford University. And it has similar toes to the geckos, which contain very tiny fibers made out of carbon. Okay? I am not sure that they show it here in large magnification, but I have another short video which I can show you. Okay, let's stop it and let's, yeah, okay. You can see the tiny hairs? You can see them, okay? Exactly like what the gecko has, okay? So this robot is climbing not because it has any adhesive, not because it applies any vacuum, okay? to the surface, but because of London van der Waals forces between these tiny hairs and the surface. Let's see another movie. It is called Sticky Gecko. Let me. Here, this is Spider-Man, by the way. Okay, a visualization of Spider-Man's fingers. You see? But in a couple of minutes, we'll get to the real thing. Yeah. So you see the gecko here. And the fact that he can move very fastly is because, as I said before, it has a control on each one of these fibers, separate control on each one of these fibers, so he can disconnect it from the surface, okay? Because in fact, the force that is acting between each one of these fibers and the surface is rather small. So it can be connected. This it can be disconnected rather easily. But the if we sum up all these forces, okay, it becomes very large. So we can see here the these fibers again. This is again to visualize, you know, the dancing of the electron clouds, okay, or the dipoles. Right. This is another robot, by the way, based on the same principle, okay? So I think that's enough. You see, it can be used for surveillance, for instance. Okay? Different purposes. Okay, so I think that... right. Okay. So the point, the main point is here that in fact, the London van der Waals forces are additive, okay? Because they are based on the interaction between many atoms that are contained within each one of these particles, right? Okay? So that's why they, once the particles are getting closer to each other, okay, they are, they may stick together. Okay, so now we have, as I said, we have the two sets of graphs. Okay, now let's talk about the Born repulsive forces. As I said before, the origin of these forces actually is from the repulsion of two electron clouds between the two particles when we further bring these particles together. Okay, now we are talking about really short distances, because here the energy is dependent on the distance to the minus 12. Okay, that very close, that's so close that we have to get between the two particles in order to sense the Born forces, which are repulsive in the same manner as the electrostatic forces, but they are much, the range is much, much shorter, as it is shown here. Okay, this is, this graph shows the whole set of energies, actually, that as a function of distance here, that we have associated between two colloidal particles. So we have the electrostatic, we have the London van der Waals, and we have the Born, which you see, as I said, the particles has to become very close to each other in order to sense them, right? Is that clear? Okay, so now what we have to do is in each distance to sum up each one of these interactions. And when we do this, this is what we get. Okay, before that, this is the whole set of equations, okay? You have the total energy, which is composed of the electrostatic energy, and the London van der Waals energy, and the Born energy, okay? And as a function of distance, you can see the electrostatic interactions are as a function of the E powered by kappa, minus kappa times the distance, okay? This is an exponential dependence. Van der Waals are according, behave according to a distance to the minus one. London behave according to the distance to the minus six. And Born behave according to the distance to the minus 12, okay? Born forces are the shortest range of forces that we know about, right? Okay? So, as I said, we have to sum up, as it is shown here, in each distance, and this is what we get. This is a well-known interaction energy graph as a function of the distance between two particles that was first generated by DLVO at that time. Okay, back to the 1930s. Okay, this was the time by which they first came with this theory. Now, it reminds you something. What does it remind you? Look at the shape of this curve. Remember the energy gap for the electrons to cross back and forth to and from the electrode, okay? Here, similarly, but for different reasons, okay? We have an energy gap. Can you see it? Can you see the energy gap? This is the energy barrier. Okay? Energy barrier, I'm sorry, not an energy gap. Okay? Let's assume that we have two particles with an infinite distance, one from the other. Okay? And we start to bring them together. Okay? They start sensing each other. And here we start, we can do the summation that we mentioned before between the three types of energies, and we get this energy barrier, because here the electrostatic forces dominate. Okay? At a certain distance, when the van der Waals, London van der Waals forces are becoming dominant, the energy decreases and becomes attractive, okay? And again, when we bring closer and closer the two particles, the bond energies are becoming dominant, so the repulsive forces are increasing again, okay? So if you if you look carefully at this plot, you can see actually three very clear features. First of all, we have here a what we call a secondary minimum, okay, which is there because of the balance between still electrostatic forces and London van der Waals forces, right? Mainly van der Waals forces, because remember, they behave as a function of h to the minus one, okay? As we go closer, in electrostatic forces become dominant, okay? And we have here the energy barrier, which in order for the particles to move closer to each other, we have to overcome. And when we overcome this barrier, we get to what we call the primary minimum. Okay? Now, these two minima are associated with two phenomena that we well know. Okay? The first one, the secondary minima, is associated with what we call flocculation. And the first minimum is associated with what we call coagulation. You are all familiar with these two terms, right? But there is a very clear difference between the two. Can somebody tell me, based on what you know and based on what you see here, what is the difference? What are the differences between these two phenomena? Coagulation and flocculation. And what does it mean?
Coagulation is balancing of the charged particles, and flocculation is formation of bigger flocks.
Okay, this is one aspect. Another aspect? Does somebody have any suggestion? I guess you are all familiar with these two terms, right? No, but that's actually what happens. But what are the characteristics of each one of these situations, okay, or these states? I didn't quite understand, Prita. No, I'm not talking about this. I'm asking what is the difference in the behavior of the system between coagulation and flocculation. Let me be...
The density of the coagulate is quite higher as compared to that of the flocculate.
The density? Why? Why the density is higher? If you look at these two minima, which tells us that the two particles that we are talking about interact stronger. The coagulation. The primary minimum, because it is much, much deeper than the secondary minimum that is very shallow. Okay? Okay? So the main difference in the behavior of these two systems, okay, or these two phenomena, is that flocculation is maybe a reversible process. Okay, there are interactions between particles while they are flocculate is very, very weak. Okay, very, very weak in a way that they can stick together, but it would be rather easy, okay, to redisperse them when it happens. Okay, let's say by mixing, by warming the suspension up a little bit, okay, increasing the temperature, maybe using ultrasound, okay, and all these kinds of methods that we have in order to keep the suspension suspended. Okay, this is flocculation. On the other hand, coagulation is a much, much stronger adhesion between the particles. Actually, it is in most cases an irreversible process. Okay, once coagulation happens, okay, it is almost impossible to redisperse the particles. Okay, this is not a chemical interaction, as was said before. Okay, not a chemical interaction. These are van der Waals, very strong van der Waals interactions. Okay, chemical interactions are actually being typified by chemical bonds, like covalent bond. Okay, and these are not. These are London van der Waals, very, very strong interactions, which are possible here because we brought the particles, we overcame the energy barrier, and by doing which it was possible to bring the two particles much closer to each other, so they will sense the London van der Waals interactions, attractive interactions. Okay, so this is a very important point for distinguishing between the two phenomena, the flocculation and the coagulation. Right? Any questions?
Water bond forces exist only between the molecules.
It between what?
Molecules.
No, not necessarily. What do you mean? I'm sorry. What do you mean by polar molecules? Dipole moments, yes, yes. Yeah, in a way, yes, yes. But I wouldn't say molecules. I would say polar entities within the particle. Okay, because they can be like with water. Okay. It can be a distribution of charges between different atoms that happens there, okay? Which create
hydrogen bond.
Excuse me?
The same about hydrogen
bonding. No, let's not get to hydrogen bonding here, okay? Hydrogen bonding is actually also a van der Waals forces, okay? But I don't want to deal with this, okay? In a way, it's similar, but not exactly. Okay, so let's not go into this right now. But but yeah, you can consider also polar molecules or polar entities within the particle. Okay, that interact between each other, and these are actually the van der Waals forces. Yes, yes. Any other questions? Is that clear?
Sir?
Yeah.
At very large distance, why there is some kind of attraction like in secondary?
At very large distances? You know, I hate to use the word very. Okay, because very is something that you don't know how to relate to it, okay? Very can be 1 centimeter, can be 1 millimeter, can be 1 micron, 1 nanometer, okay? The point is that as the particles are at distance, a large distance between each other, there will be some interaction, but very weak, because you can see that it it becomes close to zero, okay, to the origin of axis, okay. But what is the size of this energy? We don't know, because this is schematic. It depends on many factors, okay. So there is still interaction. Even you can consider interaction even at infinity, if you want, okay. But this is a, this will be a weak interaction with respect to the interaction that you have when these particles are becoming closer and closer, right? So let's leave the word very aside, okay? Another question. What is the question? Due to this type of, no, polymers are soluble in solvents because either they have electrostatic forces that put them apart from each other, okay, or they interact with the solvent itself that stabilizes them, right? Or maybe there are other forces. Van der Waals forces are there, and again, it depends on the type and on the strength of the van der Waals forces as respect with respect to the in, to the electrostatic forces, okay? Because these molecules in the solution can stick together because of van der Waals forces, and then they may precipitate because of this, okay? Which means that they become less soluble, okay? But there are many other factors that are associated with the solubility of polymers in different solvents. Okay? Other questions? You don't have any questions? This side is very active today as compared to this side. Hmm? Okay, so let's continue. Now remember that we argued before that the ionic strength has a lot to do with the stability of the particles, okay? Right? Before we are going to the to this point, I want to emphasize another point. It is understood that here in this minimum and this minimum, we can consider the suspension, collider suspension, unstable. Okay, because something will happen to this. Okay? As we go further, as we overcome this minimum, and we overcome flocculation, for instance, by mixing, okay, and as we go further, electrostatic interactions, repulsive interactions are becoming dominant. If we are not able to cross this energy barrier, the suspension will remain stable. Okay? If we manage to cross, if not we, the particles, two particles, manage to cross this energy barrier and to come to this minimum, they will become again unstable or extremely unstable, okay? Because here we get coagulation, and as we said, it is very difficult to resuspend particles that were coagulated, okay? Now, what is the influence of salt. Okay, so this is again the plot that we showed, that we showed before, and look what happened when we add salt. When we add salt, actually, the energy barrier here becomes smaller, right? Why? Do you have any clue? At the same distance, at the same distance, it becomes smaller. Why? The what? The? What about the presence of charged particles? What happened to the two electrical double layers associated with the particles? Okay, when we increase the ionic strength, what? They shrink. Okay, they come closer and closer to the particles themselves. Okay, that is why, at the same distance, the interaction between the two double layers will become smaller when we increase the ionic strength, which means that it will be easier for the two particles to overcome this energy barrier and to get to this primary minimum and to get coagulated. Okay? And it may, and it, as we increase the ionic strength, okay, the screening, we call it screening of the electrical double layer, okay? Because actually, by increasing the ionic strength, we isolate the two double layers, one from the other, right? So the particles has to become much closer in order even to sense the interaction between the two electrical double layers, okay? Now, do you know how, I mentioned it before, but let me asking you it again. How cheese is being produced in the milk industry, in the dairy industry? What do we do in the dairy industry in order to make cheese? What? This is one of the methods, but by this we get the what we call the regular cheese. I mean those, I don't know the term here in India for this purpose, but you know these heavy cheese, you know, the yellow ones, okay? How do you produce it? Remember that we mentioned the whey, the cheese water, okay? Okay? And what is it there? What do we have there? What do we have there in this way? Excuse me? What? No, I'm talking about the whey, okay? The water that comes out of the cheese industry or the solution. What does it contain? We mentioned it. What? Salt, right. Why it contains salt? Milk doesn't contain salt or very small concentrations of salt. We add salt in purpose in order to destabilize the solids, the suspended solids in the milk. Okay? And the reason is exactly because of this. We add salt in order for the suspended solids to be able to overcome this energy barrier, okay, and to coagulate. Cheese actually is a coagulant of the milk solids, right? There's another method that was mentioned, but this is not for different types of cheese, okay, to add some citric acid, you know, or calcium, these are different types of cheese, but I'm talking about the most heavy cheese, okay? That are not, by the way, these kind of cheese are not, I didn't see them that much in India, no? Especially in France, you know, and in other countries. They smell bad, usually. But that's how we make cheese, okay? And this is the chemical, physical explanation for this kind of process. We add salt in order to destabilize these suspensions. Okay? Is that clear? Any questions? Excuse me? Agglomeration? Agglomeration is more about molecules, okay? Not about colloidal particles, okay? Molecules can stick together, okay? But this is not about colloidal particles, right? Okay. What, another question? Okay. So here we have a summary, and it contains actually all the items that we mentioned before. Okay, just for you to pay attention, the in the secondary minimum where we have flocculation, actually the interaction is very weak, as we can understand, and this is about this strength, 1 to 2 kT. Yes, there was any question? No. Very weak interactions, that that is why these are the particles are flocculated, not coagulated, and I think that we said almost everything what is written here. Okay. Okay, in relation to this, I mean, to the influence of the ionic strengths on the stability of colloidal particles, we have what we call the Schultz-Hardy rule. We, if you remember how we calculate the ionic strengths, okay, this is the product of the concentration and the valency of the ions, and we do after that, we sum up all the ionic entities that we have in the solution, okay? Anions, cations, all the types of ions. And this means, actually, that those ions that have a higher valency, they dominate more, okay, or they influence more let me say it differently, they contribute more to the ionic strengths, okay? That is why if we want to destabilize a suspension, it would be more efficient concentration-wise to take highly valent ions, okay? For the same concentration, if we take a multivalent ion, it would be much more effective in decreasing the energy barrier as compared to monovalent ion. And for this purpose, we have the Schultz-Hardy rule, which says that there is a critical concentration okay, for the for a certain suspension to become coagulant, or to become coagulated, okay, and this critical coagulation concentration, which is called CCC for critical coagulation concentration, is a function of the valency to the minus 6, okay, and we have here some examples, like this is, for instance, for arsenic sulfide suspension, okay, we have here the critical coagulation concentration for different salts, different valencies, and you can see, for instance, that for the monovalent salts like lithium chloride, sodium chloride, and potassium nitrite, it is more or less the same in terms of here in terms of millimole per cubic decimeter. Okay, but if we take, instead of the monovalent cations, we take divalent cations, the critical concentration decreases significantly, okay, as a power of z to the minus 6 when we take into considerations that here is a monovalent, these are monovalent ions, and these are divalent ions, okay. And further, it is becoming, this critical concentration decreases as we take trivalent ions. For instance, here this is aluminum, here this is chromium, okay? So again, as the valency of the ions becomes larger, the salt will become more effective in terms of concentration in order to bring this any suspension into the coagulation state or coagulated state, right? So this is the Hardy-Schultz rule. Okay, is that clear? Okay, any questions about this? Yes. I would say it like this. The application is that if we want, in the industry, we would like to use as less amounts of electrolytes and materials in general as possible, okay, in order to save money, in order to less pollute the environment, and probably for many other reasons, okay. Some of the metals may be, some of the electrolytes may be toxic, okay. So we would like to avoid as much as possible using high quantities, okay. So actually, in the food industry, we are limited. We will not use, for instance, aluminum in the food industry, okay. We would like to avoid it. So we have to use mainly sodium chloride for this purpose, okay, because this is the common salt and the less hazardous salt that we know about, okay. We will not use even lithium chloride in the food industry, okay, but for other purposes where we can use different ions, we would like to save quantities, we would like to save money. So we have to know this rule in order to know what is the minimum concentration for each one of these salts we have to take in order to destabilize a certain colloidal suspension, okay? So this is more or less what I can think about the application of this rule. Okay, it's in a way, it's it may be considered as a rule of thumb, but it is not just this, because it is based actually on the way that we calculate the ionic strengths. Okay, any other questions?